So now we're going to talk a bit about some applications on the biomedical side. What is novel, what is new, and what is cutting edge? I like to take this approach and look at microscopy, specifically fluorescence, confocal, and multiphoton in different configurations known as CDAT and PINKEL. Flow analysis and fluidics. We're going to talk about flow cytometry, cell sorting, and optofluidics. And last but not least, optogenetics, which is more or less a new field, really only on the research level just yet. But what it's doing is embedding photoreceptors onto neurons to actively suppress or engage different hormones and reactions in the brain. Microscopy. Fluorescence microscopy is one of the largest and fastest growing fields in a very old technology of microscopy, which has been around for hundreds of years when researchers first looked at cells in a piece of cork. So we're going to take a look at a single band and a tri-band configuration, more commonly known as CDAT and PINKEL, for a 3-fluorophore study. So single band fluorescence filters can range anywhere from $200 to $300 off the shelf, whereas a multi-band tri-band fluorescent filter can range anywhere from $400 to $450. So in this study, if you consider a CDAT configuration that uses 7 different single band filters versus a PINKEL configuration that uses 3 multi-band tri-band fluorescence filters, the math comes out to a comparison of $2,100 versus $1,350. So significant savings in the long run, even though you're using more expensive optics. Moving forward in the microscopy, we have confocal and multiphoton, which are advanced fluorescence microscopy techniques that utilize specific UV or IR filters. So UV filters are important because you breach that diffraction limitation. If you're able to tag or use an antigen that is adept or not really harmed or photobleached by UV light, by all means, please do. You're going to get better resolution in your system and ultimately better performance or contrast. In multiphoton, you're almost exclusively using IR wavelengths. So consider a 1030 or 1070 nanometer excitation band. You're going to get some type of emission depending on the protein that you're using on the order of roughly half in the green to red wavelength, which is the opposite of what one would see in a standard fluorescence microscope. Now we're going to look at flow cytometry. Consider flow cytometry as a technology where thousands and thousands of cells and platelets or particles are being analyzed within seconds. A very high flow rate, very large pressure, and a lot of analysis being done. Over 20 filters can be used in some of these systems in a 3 to 4 channel type of system. These filters are typically extremely highly specified on the OD6 or greater. Extended blocking ranges covering 200 to 1600 nanometers. Due to the fact that there are multiple channels and multiple excitation wavelengths. And the cut-on and cut-off transitions are roughly on the order of 1% or less. Transmission is greater than 98%. And your ripple needs to be extremely flat. It has to be on the order of 1% across the bandwidth. So we'll look at two quick examples, two schematics from Becton Dickinson. In this case, we're looking at the LSR flow cytometer. That's a bit tough to follow, but if you take a close analysis here, there's ultimately 3 sources, 7 channels, and over 14 filters in this system. Again, these are all very tightly controlled, bandpass filters, beam splitters, and dichroic style filters. And another schematic here, we have the Becton Dickinson FaxVantage SC flow cytometer. Much like the previous version, this integrates more channels and more optics for a tighter application space. But ultimately, you see 10 bandpass and edge filters, along with 8 beam splitters and dichroics with an array of other optics and photonics integrated into a system. So these are extremely advanced, and the filters that are integrated into them are equally advanced. Last but not least, optogenetics, one of the most advanced and newest fields in the world of optics and biomedical engineering. It is a field that ultimately uses light to specifically control genes and neurons that have been more or less embedded with photoreceptors from the eyes. So these photoreceptors are light-sensitive proteins known as rhodopsins. Due to extreme sensitivity of inactivation and photobleaching, these are highly specific and highly controlled. So you need high quality filters such as the ones I described before. I'll give you a quick example. There's things known as channel rhodopsin and halo rhodopsin, which are very similar in nature, but different in how optics and light affect them. So on one side, you have a channel rhodopsin where these are activated by blue light. So take, for instance, you have somebody who is nutrient deficient or glucose deficient from some type of diabetic onset disease. If you have a protein known as channel rhodopsin embedded into your brain and you shine it with this blue type of light, you can encourage your brain to pump more glucose or pump more adrenaline into your system and alleviate any type of ailment or side effect to that of diabetes. And on the flip side, something known as a halo rhodopsin, which uses green light to suppress neurons in the prefrontal cortex. So if you have somebody who has Alzheimer's or some type of Parkinson's syndrome, you can control their symptoms with suppression through the halorhodopsin. Again, this is purely on the research level, and they're really trying to market this and drive it to an application, but these are some of the effects that we could see going forward. So here's kind of just a quick run through on the imaging activation and detection side of things when specifically looking at calcium signals. So these are almost exclusively in the near infrared and IR wavelengths, ranging from 940 to 1100 nanometers. But what you see is various activation signals and various emission signals with a filter profile that is tightly controlled on the order of 10 to 50 nanometer bandwidths with extremely high transmissions. So again, just more examples and more configurations for you to understand how these filters are being integrated into calcium detection signals. Thank you for listening. Again, I'm Steve Briggs. To download the presentation, please click the following link or visit our website to learn more.